Everybody set? Is this on? Is it working?
Did you cut it on?
Yeah. The light is on.
Okay. Yes, it's on. I'll turn it up.
We'll go ahead and start. I'm Marguerite Most. I teach a law practice, or I had once taught a law practice technology course this past spring with Marianne Neary, who was planning to be here and wasn't able at the last moment. So I'm going to handle all of this session. What we had thought when we proposed the session was that we'd probably be sitting around the table with maybe 10 or 12 other people and have a little discussion about what we were doing and what everyone else is doing. And so we're brand new to this. And this spring was the first time in we'd ever taught it in lesson, and we hadn't even thought of it until we heard of a session at AALL. So we would be very interested, both here and me, to hear from you all about what you think should be in this kind of course, and if you're doing something like it, what you're finding useful. So please stop me if you have particular comments, or we can talk again. Everyone do it. I thought I would begin showing you what is a final product or a part of a final product one of our students put together. And this was a PowerPoint presentation. I'm just going to show you about the first 5 or 6 of this slide. We had asked them for their final project to do a PowerPoint presentation that would be mounted on TWEN, and then to do a class presentation talking about their PowerPoint presentation. And we wanted to have them address issues that were of practical concern to lawyers out there practicing in the field. So their assignment was partly to pretend that they were giving a CLE program to some local bar association. And we told them they could have 30 minutes, and that was to include the 2 minutes at the end for moderators' questions. And this is one that I'm just going to run through a few of the slides, and then I can talk later a little bit more specifically about the project itself. This is a student who had never used PowerPoint until we moved this in the past this semester. And here, of course, she's just sort of set out what she's going to be talking about. Why email is of particular concern. We also asked them during the entire course, we were trying to include some case law, some substantive law, and also ethical concerns that might arise. She included ethical opinions. She included, as we saw before, some cases. And she talked about the statutes that were involved. Major case that we had discussed. What was going on in federal law. And I'll stop right here, because at this point she went in on to talk about encryption and explain to the rest of us what encryption actually was. show you the inside. Before we go on to actually talk about the course, I thought I would tell you a little bit about how we came to teach the course. And last summer, several of us at Boston College attended a program which Ken Hirsch is sitting up here, moderated, called Beyond the Traditional Curriculum, How to Create and Teach a Law Practice Technology Course. And Ken moderated and talked about why teaching technology was important nowadays. And there are a couple of people in on the panel. Marianne Gerber, who is at Golden Gate, and she talked about a two-credit course she had been teaching for several years, where she used a lot of software, introduction to software technology. And the other person was Sally Gerber. And she's at Wake Forest, and she at the time was preparing to teach some ground bank lunch sessions this coming fall, last fall. So we were just very impressed with what they had to say, and I'm not a technology person. In fact, you can see I'm fumbling a little bit with it, but as we listened to them, we realized that there was nothing going on at Boston College like this, and the library is very involved in this part of, technology is part of the library at Boston College, and so we decided we really should explore this a little bit more. And it sort of perked around in everybody's head for the month of August. And then we realized early in September that if we wanted to put in a proposal for a course, we better do it pretty fast. So we got it in, proposing a two-credit course to be taught, we thought, in the fall of 2005, that is, this upcoming fall. And we suggested that it would be meeting twice a week, and that we would have a mix of substantive law, ethical concerns, and an introduction to software, as the lawyer might need some knowledge of it before actually going out and practicing. So that's what we put into our proposal, and within a month, we got a message back from the academic dean saying it sounded good, and that he'd like us to teach it this past spring. So we were a little overwhelmed, as you can imagine. I'm a librarian, and Marianne is a librarian, and there was a fair amount of substantive law here, and we didn't know much about any of it. But that's where we were, round about the 1st of November of last fall. And at that point, we called in a couple of local attorneys and started talking with them about what they saw as things. And we started paying attention to what was on the blogs, the lawyers' blogs, trying to figure out what was going on in this area generally and what lawyers saw as important. And we put together the first few weeks before January when the class began. By the time the class was actually in session, we put together about the first half of the semester, and then we just kept adding on to it as we went along. And we weren't really, we didn't know how to organize it, actually. And let me see if we go on to you. I'll show you our plan. I had already planned a trip in February of the spring with my airline tickets and my daughter. So Marianne, not only did she teach half the course, she also took on a couple of extra classes when I was gone. And I wish she were here to be a part of this session. It was fun to teach with her. I've not top quite this way. And I think if we hadn't had the two of us, we could never have done it because it was just too much for us to figure out and incorporate and decide. But basically what we did was divide the work up and the subject areas up. And she would handle one class and I would handle another class. This is the American Bar Association's Legal Technology Resource Center, which we went to early on in before we even got started. If you all haven't gone to it, it's a very good way to figure out what's going on in the minds of lawyers and what their technology needs are. And there are, in fact, I'll show you a book of each other. This is one page there which deals with electronic filing. And you can see on the right-hand side there all the links to what's going on in various state courts. There are lots of PowerPoint presentations here on the site where they've been used for CLE for attorneys. And there are lots of good articles. So it's a very useful site. And we did use this heavily as we were trying to figure out what to do. We have divided the class up. I would say these are the major elements that we felt we wanted to try and incorporate into the class. We wanted to talk about the life of the electronic document, the ethical components. We wanted to introduce students to law firm software and actually give them some hands-on. And because we knew pretty early on that we couldn't do it all ourselves, we thought we'd use practitioners and experts as much as we could. And then we wanted to be sure that some presentation skills were incorporated into the course. I guess there are several different ways to organize this course. This is, again, how we decided to organize it, because as we started reading, it seemed as though most of the issues that law technology and software programming, everything's sort of dealt with documents in one way or another. So if you look at the syllabus, for example, just take a minute and take a quick glance through that. If you look at the syllabus, how we moved over on. talk, in addition to retention policies, there's a case out there right now, again, I've never heard of it, called Zubalock, which we seem to discover that electronic discovery is a really hot issue right now. And the Zubalock case deals with electronic discovery, and it's a very large case coming out of New York federal courts, where there were some pretty egregious erasings of emails and disappearing messages and all kinds of stuff that the courts weren't very pleased to discover was happening. And there were issues of who should pay for the discovery of a lot of electronic data. We followed this Zubalock case. It went back to court 5 different times. And it just came out again in April. But it was a good case for us to kind of follow through and talk to the students about what was going on in the cases. The main bar overseers, I stuck that up because it's just one example of how we incorporated an ethical component into the course. What goes on with electronic documents, and what does the main bar opinion, ethics opinion, have to say about how long you must retain paper copies? Or if you have to at all. These are just some of the issues that we thought were important in the ethics component. The metadata event, electronic discovery, what happens when you do away with electronic evidence, and again, the ethics opinions. We talked about email and IM communication and encryption. We talked about law firm websites and marketing and when an attorney-client relationship begins. What happens? When are you giving legal advice? These are all issues that at the moment are really changing because the way lawyers are practicing law, and it's really, really changing compared to what it was like when I was worrying about such things. One of the first cases we had them look at was, this is our title for it, this is a case in which Marvel Semiconductors called up Jasmine Networks, and they had their speakerphone on because they thought they were going to have a conference call, and they couldn't get through to Jasmine. So they asked that Jasmine's executives call them back. And no one thought to turn off the speakerphone after that. And not only was the request to call back recorded on the Jasmine voicemail message, but in addition to that, there was a long, long conversation about, well, you know, how we're going to get away, what we are doing, like stealing the employees. Stuff you wouldn't want your opponent to hear about. And the whole issue became, well, is this what kind of evidence is this? Is this evidence that can be brought into court? It was a very interesting case, and it was a very short case. So students found it easy to understand. It was an immediate drawing because everybody knows what a speakerphone is and a voicemail message machine is. But we try to incorporate something like this in every class we do. Law firm software. Some of what we did with hands-on use of software, for example, our students had never actually used site checking or reformatting software with Westall or Lexis, so we just had the reps come in, and that took about 15 minutes of hands-on for each of those two systems. They were really glad to know about it because in their first year courses, they didn't get access to that. There are lots and lots of different kinds of very sophisticated software programs out there which law firms are buying. And our approach was simply to let students know what kinds of software was out there. We didn't actually try and train them on more complicated systems, the case management systems, the time billing systems. partly that was because we had some trouble convincing software programs that we were a serious market, I guess is the best way of saying it. They didn't really want to give us access to Time Matters, which is a Lexis product, for example. Hot Docs, which is a document assembly product from Lexis. I think that could change because if we had started a little bit earlier, if we'd known a year ahead, I think we could have really worked our way in and gotten more a hold on some of that. And we probably will give them more exposure, hands-on exposure, this coming spring. Abacus, which is one of the software programs which was mentioned yesterday in a different class, did give us free software. I just had to ask for it, basically, and I had to pay for the shipping. And then it took us a while to get it. It was kind of back and forth, and we had to wait for our IT, who of course had other priorities, to get the chance to put it on when the labs weren't busy. But it turned out to be a pretty effective hands-on demonstration for them. I put in a little bit of client information. I made up some client information so they had a chance to see when conflicts could arise. For example, using the software. This is a software that lets you schedule. It lets you track your clients and identify client conflicts. So that's one where they actually did have some hands-on. Crawl on Track is the biggest electronic discovery software company around at the moment. And Marion simply called up Crawl on Track and asked if there was anyone who would come. And 3 days later, we got a nice telephone call back from this young man who used to be he's a law school graduate at Stanford, who then went into technology out in the Silicon Valley doing something, and had hooked in somehow with his Crawl on Track and wanted to get his name out, I suspect. But he came in and did a wonderful demonstration. He gave students his big notebooks about electronic discovery, and wants to go back next year. So we were really pleased. West KM, we had trouble figuring out where to go for West KM. We wanted our students to at least know what knowledge management is. And our local representatives could not give us any names. Again, this was Marianne, kind of rural, and she just kept at it. And eventually we ended up with a man who was an engineer, a development engineer, who came in from West and talked, and he got an excellent review, evaluation by our students. They just thought he was wonderful. Pacer, we have Pacer in the library, and we actually did a training, hands-on session where they had to go through and do some exercises. Hot Docs, we never did get. We realized, as I said earlier, early on, that we didn't know very much about this area. So we turned to all these different groups of people for help. For example, with the Boston College Law School faculty, we had a young woman on the faculty who was very enthusiastic when I asked her if she'd come in. She teaches civil procedure. I asked if she would come in and talk to the class about jurisdiction and what issues might be floating out there because of the internet. And she gave them a couple cases to read and really walked them through all of the various issues dealing with forum shopping, for example. And I think it was something she hadn't had a chance to cover in her first year civil procedure course, and she was just extremely enthusiastic about having a class of second and third year students who were interested in this. The vendors I've already mentioned, we used a lot of them, a number of vendors, and they generally, the ones who came were very good and very interested, and they weren't really pitching their products particularly. We brought in some people from law firms, chief information officer, for example, from a law firm down in Austin. Litigation support staff, again, we asked people from firms, and we got some from the Department of Justice. And then ongoing involvement with the federal district court. One of the judges in Boston is very interested in technology and uses it in the courtroom here. And he just happened to have scheduled, separate from us, a motion session at the law school early in the semester. So we had our students sit in on that motion session just to get a feel for him and what he was like. And then we actually took him on a field trip down to the court. I was a little concerned because I thought, well, is this like a kindergarten class visiting a firehouse? But they loved it. And none of them had been to that federal court before, and most of them had not actually observed a trial before. And then afterwards, the judge took, we only had 8 students in this class, the judge took us into his chambers and sat us around along with his court reporter and talked with the students for quite a long time, an hour and a half, 2 hours, about what was going on in his courtroom and the kinds of problems they were encountering and what they expect lawyers to know about technology and filing papers and all of those kinds of things which are floating around out there in the days. Presentation skills, we felt it was important for them to be able to get up in front of a group, and we especially felt this was important when we saw how very nervous they were when they did their very first 10-minute PowerPoint presentation on metadata. And they were extremely uncomfortable. And these were second and third year students. We expected them to be more comfortable. Marion and I are not particularly awesome or frightening figures, and they already knew each other. So we were very surprised. I think next year we will make them have to do more presentations of one kind or another, where they actually have to stand up in front of you. We did want that teamwork element in there, and just a couple of other things. We talked about animation and trials, for example. Again, what kinds of presentation skills are important, what's fair, what's ethical, what can you do, what can you not do. We talked for a while about the scaffold trial, and they watched a little videotape, a little video clip of some of what was going on in there. This was because it was in the news at that time. And then the final project, you saw one example of their final project. Let me stop for a moment and see if anybody has questions.
Well, is this a graded course?
Yeah. And in fact, we didn't know this when we started the semester, but we were supposed to give a final exam in this course. And we had told the students that they would be graded 40% on a final project. And then they had a weekly assignment. I'll show you in a minute when I go over to the 10th page. And they had a series of small projects, and we had no intention. We weren't giving them a final exam, so we had to kind of clear that along the way. But I would never change that. I don't think there's a need for it. There's not an exam here. I think this was the way to credit it, that it wasn't a very good course. Yes?
Do you use, for your clinic, do you have clinics at your law school?
Mm-hmm.
Do you use some of the software for
time
management now?
Time Matters was just being put into the clinic in January of this year. And I looked at it, and I just felt that I couldn't pull it together enough myself to teach. You know, we just happened to take a look at the demo on the website, but it's pretty superficial.
Do you link this class with your clinical students in like a prerequisite sense or anything like that?
The only thing we were concerned about with this class was that we didn't want to duplicate anything that was going on in our advanced legal research class, which was being taught at the same time. And as it turned out, we had 2 students who took both classes, and I don't think there was any duplication or overlap.
Yeah, what do you think would be the maximum class size?
21, and I think that would be absolutely the top one. I mean, to make it comfortable. Partly because the presentations take a long time. Yes?
What kind of readings are you having? Are they taking anything like you need a journal and things like that?
Let me just get out of this and go to the next one. We didn't use as many of the features, I suspect, as you talked about this morning in your class, and I'm not going to really talk about TWEN itself, but I can show you on the right-hand side, we have both our assignment posted here. Let me just show you one. This is the assignment. We have them post once a week to a student discussion list, which is on point here. And if you look at the very last page of the syllabus, you'll see the blogs we ask them to use. By the end of the semester, they were saying they were having trouble finding postings that weren't duplicating their fellow students' postings. And we had thought about a credit discussion list because that was a suggestion they gave us at the end. We just kind of felt, Marianne and I felt, we couldn't handle it this semester. We probably will do it next semester. But we did want to make sure that they themselves each posted something every week. Some of the other assignments. I talked about the metadata assignment, security in the law firm. We brought in the head of security at Boston College, who talked with them generally about security, and then we talked quite a bit about various kinds of concerns that a lawyer might have in keeping his client's information secure, for example. And then we gave them an assignment in which they were asked to write two memos. One was a memo to clients, assuming they were lawyers in a small firm. One was a memo to clients in which they would tell the client what kinds of security measures were being taken by the law firm. The other was one page. The other was a maximum of two pages in which they were to be the attorney who kind of knew about technology in their small 10-person firm, and they were supposed to clue in the rest of their colleagues at the firm about what was and what was not permissible, including, don't leave your laptop sitting in the library because somebody might walk off with it, to why should you use or not use your laptop with wireless security at the local Starbucks, to this is what you need to do with your in data and backing up tapes, all of those kinds of issues that arise. We didn't ask them to come up with product names. We just wanted them to understand what these issues were. Then it's on e-discovery. This assignment was one dealing with a couple of cases where the federal courts, circuit courts have split, and it really is a hot topic right now, so we asked them to compare the cases, read the cases from two different circuits, and come up with where they think the courts are going. And then we had some other small assignments, like the pace or hands-on exercise, those kinds of things. Yeah.
What feedback or comments did you get from other faculty? Did they think, you know, no place for that in the law school, or were they all like, oh, that's really great?
The comments we've had, which have not been many, have been positive. The academic dean, we've met with a couple of times over the semester, once because we needed to talk with him about the fact that we were doing the exam, and he was, he's been very supportive. The faculty who came in to visit, or to teach, again, were very supportive. Yeah.
Did the curriculum come in at Boston College?
Yeah.
Did they review it at all, or just go straight to the dean? How nice for you.
It wouldn't have been very nice before. No, that's very true. I can't imagine. As I said, we were very surprised. We didn't expect to have the chance to do this. It was very nice to have the support of the library directors. And I think because we came in with a proposal that was pretty well-rounded and quite specific. He actually saw some of our syllabus in this fairly detailed format.
You're going to show us some of the readings you did?
Oh, sure. Thank you. First one, the impact of the internet on the practice of law. This was before their first class, and it's a larger article from Richmond Law and Technology or some such. And then we had asked them to come into that first class and thinking about a number of questions about how the internet was changing the way we live and the way we practice law. Most of the articles were smaller articles, short news articles, for example. But we did put some cases up there. ABA Journal, Top 10 in Technology, for example. 20 tips for websites. We had them both read assigned readings where we expected them to come into class having read them, and we had pretty good discussions all the way through the semester. And then we also had some supplemental readings.
Did you find it difficult to get students to participate?
No.
Did you have to ask a lot of questions to get them out there?
It really depended on the topic. And with it, when we did the presentation on electronic discovery, and had someone come in to talk to them about software. Now, these were second and third year students, but one of the comments we got afterwards from one of the students who was a second year student was, I don't understand what discovery is. And we just hadn't realized. He had civil procedure, but nevertheless, he didn't really understand. So I think, obviously, we didn't prepare him well enough for that. For the most part, I think they were okay. We did include some background information in some areas because we needed it as much as anything. Yeah.
Administrative question. On the schedule you said you went through earlier, did you actually announce the course before spring registration?
It was announced. Sign up for spring registration is in the fall. However, it wasn't accepted until
right,
and it was announced in January.
So how did you promote it to your students since they already registered for spring classes?
We didn't, really.
And how many signed up anyway?
Eight. Yeah. We didn't. Showed up on the if you want to switch classes at the last.
Well, and drop out. Yeah.
Exactly. That's the word.
That's pretty good. People adding a class they never heard of before.
They knew. All of the librarians are involved in teaching the first year program. Most of them are. And so the students do know something about this. Is there a question?
I just wanted to make a comment. We've been teaching the law practice management class for the last few years. We always seem to slip in the cracks. They don't seem to announce us at the time they're supposed to start signing up for this. So we have to do a lot of drop that. We typically have either 30 or 60 students sign up or drop that and take this class. I mean, they want this stuff.
Yeah, I think they do want it.
the school is still going through the accreditation process, we need to review this year, but the technology representative, the guy who was evaluating the technology, actually asked me specifically about whether or not we were teaching this sort of stuff. He was actually looking to see if the school was equipping their students in the use of technology.
We did have an ABA accreditation visit this spring, Boston College. Maybe that was another little. Anything else? Is there anything else here to show you? I had some trouble with some of the discipline. For example, we wanted to do evaluations, and there isn't any, or at least there wasn't at the time. Any place for online evaluations, and I made it up by using the quiz feature. Yeah, I'll just show you the evaluation from one of the students. This is Charles Shipman, the SKM engineer who came in, the one we kind of had to beg many times before we could get him, but the students just loved him. So if we take a look at, here's a response from the students about West Cam. Yes, I was a bit familiar with Cam systems, but the readings gave me some more background. They were answering specific questions that we had posted. And they can't spell, but this one couldn't.
Well, they all got incorrect.
Most definitely, because the firm I'll be working at for summer uses West Cam. And for giving a presentation of West Cam, he was just about right, considering it's not the most exciting software in the world. I think, again, something I'll be using this summer and out of practice. One of the things the students really liked was the idea that at least when they walked into the law firm, they kind of knew what time management systems were or what a document assembly system is. Even though they hadn't done much of it, they weren't entirely blank. And then with some, where they had the hands-on with Pacer, for example, they were really pleased with that because some of them had actually had to use Pacer and felt really out of place the year before. Question?
With the third years, did you find that they had already had a lot more introduction to some of the material during their summers?
One student...
billing?
No. And these were going... These were pretty good-sized Boston offerings a month. One student who was working the summer before at an IT firm had used the Time Matters program, where she learned how to use it at the phone for the secretary. But none of the others, and most of them were third-year students. By the way, one of the second-year students who did a final presentation on jurisdictional issues on the internet for his big project. Is going to be doing that as a ground bag lunch at the law firm in Milwaukee where he works this summer. He was absolutely thrilled that he was invited to come in and do this ground bag lunch as soon as he arrived. So it was kind of nice to see them have something hands-on that was useful to them. Anything else out of general?
Quick question, is your TWEN page open for others to look at?
Mm-hmm. That's why I gave you the service. But really, you can put it together from the paper and or something very like it. And I think our readings will change because things are changing so fast. I imagine most of the reading assignments we gave them will be there next spring. Other questions?
Marguerite, what would you do different?
Oh, I wanted to talk about that. We had a two-hour class that met twice a week, and we're going to change it to 1 hour next spring, partly because the 15-minute class, there just wasn't time when we had visitors for them to come in, get things set up, do a presentation, and then follow through and have time for student questions. So what we did when we had visitors was often to make it an hour and a half class, and you were just able to do that by a lot of juggling. next semester we'll have, next spring we'll do just one session a week.
2 hours?
2 hours. Hour and a half or something. 250 minutes, 100 minutes. Whatever that
is.
That's one thing. I had a whole little list of those. Getting them to do everything, you know. Okay.